Today I'm going to show you how to build different types of grids in SwiftUI. You'll learn about LazyVGrids in section headers, LazyHGrids, and static grids. Today's video is sponsored by Squarespace. Here I am in Xcode, and I do have a small starter project to save some time. But as you can see, I just have a tab view set up between LazyGrids and static grids, and there's no code written in those views, but I did create some mock data to save some time, and I'll show that to you real quick. So I have an extension on color just to get a random color. As you see here, we deal with random colors. And then the mock data here, I'm just creating an array of 30 of these colors so we can populate our grid. Now, this is the first key thing. These LazyVGrids take an array of data. We're using colors, but another example could be an array of users, as you see here with like an avatar and a username. Or on this calendar, my app creator view, I pass in an array of days and I populate this calendar, which is just a LazyVGrid with those days. But again, we're just creating random colors to keep this simple for the tutorial. All right, so back to the LazyGrid view. Again, I haven't written any code, just have this text in here. Well, let's replace this with our LazyVGrid, and you can see the initializer here takes column, alignment, spacing, pin views, and the content. We're just gonna do columns and content for right now. We'll come back and revisit those parameters later. Again, start with the basics and work our way up. When dealing with a LazyVGrid, the V stands for vertical, right? So we need to tell it how many columns to have. And that is an array of grid items. As you can see here, the default it gave us is an array, one grid item, fixed of 20. So you can see our placeholder text is one column, only 20 points wide. Obviously, that's not what we want. For our first example, we're gonna do grid item, and we're gonna use dot flexible, but you can see there's adaptive, fixed, and then flexible is what we're gonna use. Again, we'll come back and I'll show you how to tweak all those. We're not gonna do minimum and maximum for now. Again, I'll come back and show you that. Starting off super simple. So we just want one grid item, flexible, give me my content, and the content, I don't want these text placeholders. What I want is for each data and content. So the data is this mock data that I've created here. I'm gonna do mock data.colors, right? That's just an array of 30 colors. So back to LazyGrid view and type in mock data.colors, and then ID is /self for the color. And then the view I wanna pass in here, we're just gonna do a rounded rectangle with a radius of 10. And the fill is going to be $0 because that's each item in this color array. As you can see, it's giving us one big column, very thin color. That's not what we want. So let's do dot frame with a height of 100. And then this dot fill, we're gonna do dot gradient on the color, right? So let me run through this real quick. We're doing a for each over our colors array. For every random color that we have in our colors array, let's create a rounded rectangle, fill it with that color. That's what this $0 is. That's every item in that colors array. Make it a gradient and then give it a frame height of 100. Now again, this rounded rectangle is the basic view. Going back to this example using users, right? This view we built was avatar view and a name view. Going back to my calendar example, this is a day view and it can hold schedule items in there, right? These views can get complex. We're keeping it simple with just colors and shapes for the tutorial. So what we have here is 30 colors stacked on top of each other, but that's not how we want it, right? I can't scroll it or anything like that. So almost all the time with a LazyVGrid, let's highlight this, put a curly brace. You're gonna want it in a scroll view. So now there it is. There's our 30 colors in the scroll view. And let's put some padding on our LazyVGrid just to not make it look so cramped. There we go. Now, let me explain what lazy means. So we have 30 colors, but right now you see, I don't know, 7 or 8 on the first screen. Well, that means the other 23, 22 colors aren't loading yet. They're kind of coming lazily when we need them. Now, when you have 30 colors or items or whatever, not a big deal. If we had 300, well, yeah. Now, if you're loading all those up front, that's not very efficient. So if we had 300, 3000, we're only gonna load what is needed for the screen. That's why it's called a LazyVGrid. Okay, you're probably saying, Sean, that's not a grid, that's a list. Like, let's get some more columns in there. You're right. So this is an array of columns that we have here. So let's experiment with this a little bit. So I have grid item of flexible. So there's one of them. So I copy that, comma, paste another one. Boom, two columns. There we go. Now it's starting to look like a grid. Space another one, three columns. Oh, there we go. Let's get crazy, four. Let's get crazy, five. So you can see by giving the number of columns on the LazyVGrid, you're setting some rules, some parameters. And you'll notice that's why we didn't declare a width on our rectangle, right? Because we're gonna have our rectangle shrink so it can fit five columns, and you can see that playing out. Now I know your view may need a minimum width, right? You can't make it super skinny. We'll come back to that in a second, but I wanted to point out how you can determine the number of columns here. But you may also be thinking, this is horrible code. This is so confusing. What are you doing? This is crazy. You're exactly right. Let's rewrite this array of grid items here as a variable. So we'll say let columns equal array. And we're gonna repeat the element of a grid item dot flexible. And we're gonna repeat that 5 times to keep what we have. And instead of this garbage here, get that out of here. We're just gonna say columns, right? That's a bit cleaner. So now we can say, okay, I want 10 columns. There we go, that doesn't look that great. Let's go back to 2 columns and maybe 3 to make it look more like a grid. Okay, remember how I said we didn't determine a width, we just determined a height, so our width is gonna be dynamic to fit on the screen. Well, let's say the view we built, right, we can't have it squeezed too small. We do need a minimum width. So that's where in this flexible, you saw me do it before, the minimum and maximum, right? So we'll just do the minimum for now. So we'll say the minimum has to be 200, just for an example purposes, right? We have a pretty big view. Well, this is kind of contradictory, right? Because we told it we need a minimum of 200, but we need 3 columns, right? We're telling it 3 columns. So you can see it's cutting off the other columns. Now that could be an interesting look if you're doing this just for visual purposes, right? Maybe like a background of a view or something, I don't know. But most likely this cutting off the views is not what we want. So maybe if we said minimum of 20, now you see the views are more than 20 because, right, it's stretching to fill up what it needs. Now let's explore some of the other types of grid items to see their effect. So instead of grid item.flexible, we can do grid item.fixed. And this is pretty self-explanatory. So we'll say fixed 200, count 3. Each column is gonna be 200 points wide, no matter what. As you can see, that doesn't quite work. 100 doesn't quite work. I don't think you'll use this very often. I'm sure there's absolutely a use case for it. But you know, in the age of iPads, iPhones, landscape, not landscape, having a fixed size, usually want the UI to be able to adapt. But again, if you want it to be no matter what, each column this width, no matter what, there you go, fixed sizes for you. Now let me show you adaptive, because that one's pretty cool. So we'll get rid of this whole array here and just create an array of one grid item, and that is going to be dot adaptive with a minimum, I don't know, let's say 60. So again, what you're saying with adaptive is fit as many as you can on the screen with a minimum of 60. And this minimum is, you know, whatever works for your UI. All right, so for example, this grid of avatars, I need my view to be big enough so you can see the picture in the name and it doesn't get squished, right? So there would be a minimum size for whatever UI you're building. But again, adaptive says, okay, there's my minimum size, fit as many as you can on the screen. So you see in portrait, I get 5 columns, but when I run it and go to landscape, you'll see it adapt to landscape and squeeze more in based on the screen size. So again, we got 5 across in portrait, rotate to landscape, boom, now I got whatever, 10? Yeah, 10 across, and you can imagine on a big iPad. So adaptive is cool, like I said, to repeat to make sure you understand it. Here's my minimum size, fit as many as you can on the screen. That's how adaptive works. And again, if you want to control the columns, we'll just comment this out so I don't have to keep deleting it here. Say let columns equals array, repeating grid item dot flexible count of 4. With flexible, you have control over the amount of columns, whereas adaptive, you don't have control over the amount of columns, but it will fill it. Again, with flexible, when I go into landscape, it's going to stretch it, right? It's going to say 4 columns. It'll keep the 4 columns. It just stretches the items. So again, what you need will depend on what kind of UI you're building. Okay, let's stop this and talk about some of the other parameters in LazyVGrid. So we had columns, now we have spacing. Spacing, we'll say 40, just to be exaggerated here on our preview. Basically, this is vertical spacing. So you see our vertical spacing on the grid got a lot bigger. And if you want to control the horizontal spacing in between each row, you do that in the grid item. So the grid item also has a spacing parameter. So we'll say 50. So you can see a big space horizontally as well. Again, you can play around with these numbers, tweak it to get the design you want. But if you want the spacing per row, you do it up in the grid item. If you want the vertical spacing between each row, you do it down here in the spacing parameter on the LazyVGrid, as you see here. Okay, so let's get rid of the spacing parameter, because as you can see, if you don't declare anything, you get the default spacing, which I think looks nice, but you may need to adjust it. So another parameter is pinned views, and we'll say dot section headers. So what is a section header? Well, as you see here, as you're scrolling up, the section header will be there and it stays pinned depending on what section you're on. So to do that, we can create a section with content and header. So the content we already have, right? The content is going to be our for each with our rectangles. And then our header here is going to be just a text that will say favorites, and that will be dot font of dot large title dot bold. Just make it big and bold. So see, we have it there in the middle. We don't want it in the middle. So we'll do frame max width and alignment. So we'll do max width dot infinity and alignment dot leading. That'll push the favorites over. And then now what I'll do is I'm gonna copy this all together to make our second section. That way we have 2 sections so you can see the scrolling. Our second section, instead of favorites, we'll say don't like. I don't like these. So when I'm scrolling, you see I have favorites, and now favorites stays pinned to the top. and then I see don't like, and then when don't like gets there, we push favorites out, and now don't like stays pinned to the top for the next section of the grid. So you can break your grid into different sections with some pinned headers. And again, that was based on this parameter here, pinned views, and we're pinning our section headers. Okay, so that's LazyVGrids, and again, the V stands for vertical, so LazyHGrids, horizontal grids. Let me show you that, and all the concepts are the same, so this is gonna be really quick. Except I'm not gonna have all these section headers and everything like that. So what I'm going to do is comment out our entire scroll view here. So comment that out, keep it there, and then we'll create a new one. So we'll say scroll view, except axis, right? We want axis this time because we want a horizontal scroll view. And we'll say lazy H grid. You see, it's different just a little bit. It's rows instead of column. That's the only difference, right? You see, we get alignment, spacing, pin views, content, same thing, except instead of columns, you're dealing with rows, but they're still grid items. It's not different. So let's say let rows equals an array repeating. We're gonna repeat grid item, except this time we are gonna do fixed because we're scrolling horizontally. Fixed actually makes a lot of sense for horizontal H stacks, not so much for vertical ones though. So fixed, we'll say, 100. And then how many rows do I want? Let's say I want 3 rows, right? We have 30 colors, 3 rows of 10. So for rows, I'm just gonna pass in rows that I just created, and then content, not the text placeholder. So for the content, we're gonna pass in our for each, same data that we passed in for our lazy V grid, and there's some stuff commented out. So we'll uncomment this, highlight it all, do a control I to line it up, make it look nice. Okay, so we have our row height of 100. So we're kind of duplicating that here. So let's change height to width. Again, you're kind of dealing with different dimensions when you talk about H grids and V grids. Again, let's get some padding on our grid here just to make it look decent. And then now we can scroll horizontally as you see here. So again, all the same concepts apply to the V grid. You're just now dealing with rows instead of columns and you're scrolling horizontally. So make sure on your scroll view, you go across the horizontal axis. Before I show you how to use the new static grids that were introduced in iOS 16, I think it's a must that an iOS developer that is looking for a job have a portfolio website to showcase their projects. And that brings me to today's sponsor, Squarespace. Squarespace is an all-in-one platform to help you get that iOS developer portfolio, blog, or personal website up and running very quickly. Now I know we're all developers with the skills and the desire to build the web page ourselves, but I would argue there's an opportunity cost to your time. If you're an iOS developer trying to build a great product, a great app, maybe spending a lot of time learning the ins and outs of web development, responsive design, isn't the best way to spend your time. That's why I recommend Squarespace to build that personal website, the blog, your portfolio, or maybe a landing page for your app. They have all kinds of beautiful themes and templates to get you started. They handle all the analytics and the SEO for you. Again, it just saves you so much time so you can get back to doing what you want to do, and that is building iOS apps. So when you're ready to get started, go to squarespace.com to start your free trial. And when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/SeanAllen to get 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. Let's talk about the main differences between the static grids and the lazy V grids. With static grids, you basically have full control. You're doing everything manually. To compare that to the lazy grids, if you remember, we defined parameters, right? We said, here's how many rows, here's how many columns, here's an array of data to populate this, right? An array of colors, an array of users, and then take that array and populate the grid full of this specific type of view, right? One view. So the benefit is that it's dynamic. It can handle 10 items in that array, or it can handle 1,000 items in that array, right? That grid will be dynamic and can handle it. But you don't have a lot of manual control. And again, that's where static grids come in. So yes, you do have a lot of control. Each row in the grid can be very, very different, but the trade-off is that it's not dynamic, like it's static. You need to know all the data that's going into this grid ahead of time. The most common use of static grids is probably text and like a setting screen, like you see here for a Mac app, right? You can see each of the columns, and you can see the column on the left is right aligned, and then the column in the middle is left aligned, and then you got a column of buttons on the right, and then this bottom piece is actually taking up 2 columns. So the example I'm gonna show you is gonna use shapes and buttons, but at the end of the day, it's gonna give you the basic building blocks, the puzzle pieces to be able to create whatever UI you want or a basic text setting screen like this. Okay, so let's replace this text. This is just now a grid, not a lazy V grid, not a lazy H grid, just a grid. But a grid is composed of grid rows. So you do grid row, and then alignment and content. We'll come back to the alignment in a little bit. So now this row, I create whatever I want. Let's say, for example, I want a rounded rectangle with a corner radius of 8 and the dot fill dot pink dot gradient. And I want the frame to be 100 by 100. And then remember, in the lazy V grids, all the views had to be the same. Well, now I can do, I don't know, say a V stack, right? You can kind of do whatever you want here. We'll say circle.foreground style.secondary. And then below that V stack, we'll do a text. Well, actually, let me do a frame with height of 60 by 60 And then below that, a text of Sean. And then one more to really illustrate the point, we'll say another VStack. We'll say, hey, this one can have a button that says tap me. And the action is, you know, whatever. Dot button style, dot bordered prominent. Lastly, real quick, below that button, we can have a toggle that says volume. And then isOn will be tied to isOn, state private var isOn equals false. And then these labels are making things look weird, so we'll say labels hidden. So the point is that I can have a row of anything I want. I'm not bound to just like one view type, and that's just one row. So for the next row, save some time here, copy, paste. Cool, now there's another row. So again, you're manually building the grid based on these puzzle pieces of each grid row. Now there's a couple of different modifiers you can use to customize things that are interesting that we'll touch on. But before we do that, I wanna show you the parameters on grid itself. So we'll say horizontal and vertical spacing, 30 and 30. Again, you can customize that however you like, but it was cramped. Now we did 30 and 30. So that's how you control the horizontal and vertical spacing of the grid as a whole. Now let's start playing around with some of these modifiers. We'll just use this rounded rectangle down here on the bottom. So I got rid of the avatar view and the button and the toggle down there. And let's make this teal just to differentiate. Okay, so now that I have this isolated rectangle, let's play around with it. Let's not hard code the width. Let's get rid of that so it's just a hard coded height. So it's gonna expand, as you see, to take up whatever space is available in that column. You notice the columns on the right pushed it off to the side. Well, this allows us to do a couple different things. So up here on the red square, I can have the modifier dot grid column alignment, and now we can do right dot leading. Watch the red square go over to the left. Okay, dot trailing, watch it go over to the right. So back to my Mac example of the text, you can see this is how you right align the columns if they're not all the same sized objects. Okay, so let's comment that out. And then back down to our teal rectangle. What if I want this to take up more than one column? So you can do dot grid cell columns, right? Okay, one column, that's as it is right now, two columns. Okay, now you see it's only taking up the first two columns. And this is what's going on, again, back to this Mac example, the checkbox at the bottom, it's taking up the last two columns. And as you can see in this code right here, there's a clear space spacer that you can add. But back to our teal square, or you could take up three columns. Let's add some padding to our grid so it's not ridiculous looking. But that's the basic puzzle pieces, right? You have the overall grid where you can adjust horizontal and vertical spacing. You manually create your grid rows of whatever views you want. As you can see, I used a variety of different views. You can also have dividers between your rows. I forgot to showcase that here. So now you can see, boom, there's a divider there. And then you can also adjust the sizing of the divider. And then you can use these modifiers like grid column alignment to align things left or right and have an item in a certain row take up multiple cells as you see with the big teal box here down at the bottom. And you can add spacers using this code here as you see in this Mac example in that bottom row with the checkbox. So those are the basic building blocks and puzzle pieces for static grids. Again, the most common use case that I've seen is lining up text like this in like a setting screen. But now that you have the puzzle pieces and the building blocks, build whatever you like. Hope you enjoyed the video. We'll see you in the next one.